In San Francisco, we can virtually bring the city to a standstill, but now we can move across the country, and by doing so, we make each other stronger.
So what's the message today?
Message is, look out. Here we come.
According to Kinsey, one out of every 10 of us is a homosexual. It used to be that it was something to hide. But last October, the homosexuals of this country publicly proclaimed themselves to be the newest legitimate minority. They did it just like all the others before them, with a march on Washington.
All right, get it!
They came from every state in the Union to deliver what they felt was an historic message.
You know us, America. We are some of your best friends. We're some of your best relatives. Your sisters, your brothers, your mothers, your fathers, your daughters, and your sons. Listen, America, in the 80s, we are moving from gay pride to gay politics. Gay politics.
For someone of my generation, it sounds a bit preposterous. Political power for homosexuals? But those predictions are already coming true. In this report, we'll see how the gays of San Francisco are using the political process to further their own special interest, just like every other new minority group before them. Gay power, gay politics. That's what this report is about. It's not a story about lifestyles or the average gay experience. What we'll see is the birth of a political movement and the troubling questions it raises for the 80s, not only for San Francisco, but for other cities throughout the country. These women took weight off and keep it off with the Prolamine plan.
I lost all the weight that I wanted to lose with Prolamine. If I gain a pound or two, I'll take Prolamine for a few days until I get back to my normal weight.
Prolamine's strong, hunger-curbing ingredient is medically proven to help you stick to a diet and lose weight.
After I took a Prolamine capsule, I didn't feel hungry anymore. Occasionally, I do overeat, and I go back on the Prolamine plan, and I keep my weight down.
Take weight off and keep it off with Prolamine.
All set for the dance number, Miss Lenska.
I'm Lula Lenska. Making a movie means long days of filming. But with Alberto VO5, I never worry about my hair. Alberto VO5 holds an incredible 14 hours, and it's never stiff or sticky. It keeps my hair looking terrific, even through a tough dance sequence like this.
Lula, you're incredible.
And VO5 gives an incredible 14-hour performance.
I think that the gay phenomenon is manifesting itself perhaps initially in San Francisco, but that you're going to see similar things occur in almost all of the large metropolitan cities in this country and eventually in the world.
San Francisco's Gay Freedom Band playing the theme song from Superman. It's a message they've been taking to homosexuals all across the country. They're saying, come out of the closet. You don't have to be afraid anymore. Come to San Francisco. Because there, to be gay is to be proud and powerful. A gathering of San Francisco's gay elite. It used to be that people who looked like this belonged to the straight world.
Welcome back to Jamaica. Thank you.
Or so we thought. But most of these men are homosexuals, and they're very much a part of this city's establishment.
My clients must be paying their bills. I haven't heard from you lately.
For instance, a gay publisher talking to a gay television reporter.
I think it's important to have open to gay people in highly visible positions like that.
It's a world of businessmen, doctors, dentists, lawyers, all successful, and mostly gay.
Come out of the closet. I think there are very few people in the gay community in San Francisco who would dispute the effectiveness of coming out as a political tool.
Burley Sutton is a banker. Jerry Berg and Rusty Epps are lawyers. They're part of San Francisco's gay establishment.
There are enough of us that we can flex political muscle because enough of us will go vote. There are enough of us that we can flex some financial muscle and
politicians. Well, the economics of the thing are staggering. When you think of 100,000 people with a disposable income that the average adult gay man has, 100,000 gay people living here buying property, improving property, and maintaining a lifestyle which is by and large very sophisticated, bodes well for the city in the long run.
The gays of San Francisco live all over the city, but this is the heart of their community, Castro Street. It's become the homosexual mecca of the Western world. My colleague, George Crile, was the reporter on this broadcast. Crile, along with producer Grace Diekhaus, began covering this story last June. Cleve Jones was our first guide to the Castro. He's one of the gay community's leading activists.
Whenever there's a crisis, if something bad happens, we all know to come to Castro Street. It's our neighborhood. It's where we're strongest. I have to confess, when the police announce that they are leery of coming into our neighborhood, that gives me a certain amount of satisfaction.
Powerless alone, and in your community you have strength.
Right.
Have gays now reached the peak of their political power here?
Oh no, I think it's just the beginning. Just the beginning.
Some people say that this is a phenomenon that's going to pass. It's a fad, it's going to disappear.
No, it's not a fad. The struggle involved in the lives of the individual gay people that create this movement is far too deep and far too serious to be considered any kind of a fad. We are really fighting for our lives.
By the end of 1978, the homosexual community here had not only achieved full civil rights and economic power, but it was moving provocatively into the political arena. The first gay office holder, Supervisor Harvey Milk, had begun flexing his political muscle with the mayor of the city, George Moscone. Gay votes had helped put Moscone into office, and he had become the most outspoken ally of the homosexual community. Although it wasn't visible at the time, the emergence of gay power had caused a backlash in the city, and the two men who had championed gay causes were about to become the victims of that backlash.
The date was November 27, 1978. Shots rang out at City Hall.
As president of the Board of Supervisors, it's my duty to make this announcement. Both Mayor Moscone and Supervisor Harvey Milk have been shot and killed.
Oh, Jesus Christ!
The... The suspect is Supervisor Dan White.
And so Dianne Feinstein became the new mayor, and San Francisco was about to become a dangerously divided city. Until the night of the assassinations, few people recognized the size and strength of the gay community. They were peaceful this night as they turned out to mourn their fallen leader. But 6 months later, a jury's verdict would transform them. They would learn that the assassin, Dan White, an outspoken anti-gay politician, would only have to serve 7 years for his crime.
That verdict meant that it's okay to kill faggots still, even in San Francisco. I don't re- recall exactly what I said to the crowd, but it was something along the lines of that I had been there that day, and I saw what Dan White's bullets did, and it was not manslaughter, it was murder. It was a battle cry that night. As the reports are that you apparently led the crowd running towards City Hall.
Yeah, if you want to call it a battle, call it that. I should say, though, that we didn't draw the lines. It was presented to us.
May 21st, 1979. The newspapers would call it a night of gay rage. Before it was through, scores of policemen would be injured. The new mayor locked into a city hall under siege.
How do you explain the rioting?
Well, it is hard to explain to heterosexuals, but I do not apologize for what happened that night. Part of me didn't want it to happen, and part of me was celebrating, because I knew that nobody would ever again underestimate the rage that we can muster.
Was it a rite of passage for the gay community?
Oh, absolutely. It was also a rite of passage for the straight politicians of San Francisco, who thought for so long that by murmuring platitudes, they would get our vote and our support, and that we would stay in our bars.
July 24th, 2 months after the City Hall riots, and it was election time. The gay vote was going to be a critical factor in the November mayor's race, and so Dianne Feinstein was already beginning her campaign to win that vote. But it was an awkward situation for her. The gays were mad at her for firing the pro-gay chief of police, a man they counted on as their ally.
It doesn't do any good to have a chief that may be the best thing since apple pie if the men won't follow his leadership.
I suggested, Mayor, then without wanting to debate you, that maybe we need a new police department, not a new chief.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But that wasn't the mayor's only problem. She had reservations about their lifestyles. She had even criticized them publicly for not observing community standards. And now she wanted them to know she would only go so far in courting their vote.
I've got no special biases. I've got no special hates. I want this to be a city which is well run. If you want that, then you'll be with me. Let me just finish. If what you want are platitudes and pandering, I'm not going to do it.
I want the television cameras to focus. Press focus on us and look at our numbers. And I want every bigot to look at our numbers. Look at us. Look at how many of us.
The numbers. What the mayor hadn't yet comprehended was the meaning of the sheer numbers of homosexuals here. She didn't yet realize that no politician could safely criticize these people. That soon, she would have to recognize them as the new power brokers in this changing American city.
We are not coming from the love of power. We are coming from the power of love, and that will sustain us, for we must be free. We will be free. We shall be free, because we are everywhere.
I want to demonstrate a surprising fact about Tums, and I want you to participate. Start counting when I drop Tums into this stomach acid, and stop counting when you think Tums has begun to neutralize it. Ready? Go. Stop. Tums starts to neutralize excess acid instantly, and neutralizes all of this acid in less than 6 seconds. The only way that Tums could work faster is if it worked in my hand.
When a man wears Old Spice, chances are he'll always get a warm reception. No wonder. The clean, fresh, masculine fragrance of Old Spice is a scent that women know and love. So when you're wearing Old Spice, the invitation is clear. It can really spice up your life.
Put a little spice in your life with Old Spice.
I'd like to know if you feel, as mayor of the city,
any responsibility to establish and maintain moral standards.
Absolutely. And I believe I do in every way, shape, and form. This is one of the reasons why there is, I think, some concern in the gay community about me.
There's a consequence to the homosexual lifestyle here. Traditional values are under attack. The estimates of gays in San Francisco range from 75,000 to 175,000, from 12% of the city to 25%. A Kinsey report on San Francisco's gay colony was just completed. According to its findings, the average gay man here has had sexual encounters with at least 500 different men, 28% with more than 1,000. Early, the last time we talked, you said the following. Never in the history of the world has there been so much sex available to men as there is for gay men in San Francisco.
I think that's probably true. I don't think there's any question that that's true.
And what's the consequence of that?
I can't answer that. Perhaps one of these gentlemen can take a crack at it. I don't know that there is an answer to that. I don't think that it means moral decay, if that's what you mean.
It's a question. Most San Franciscans have come to accept the open cruising on Castro Street. It's not unlike the single scene in the straight world, a place where boy meets boy in the light of day. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. When you take the next step, you find yourself in places with no counterpart in the straight world. This is not an ordinary bookstore. It's one of San Francisco's eight glory holes, a place where gay men come for anonymous sex. Establishments like this, along with the bathhouses and S&M parlors, have always existed in one form or another in most every major city of the world. The difference in San Francisco is that there are more of them, and they've been able to come out of the shadows and achieve an aura of respectability here. The authorities take the position that government has no business interfering with them, that what goes on inside are essentially private acts carried out by consenting adults. The key word here is private. But the question is, where do you draw the line? For instance, should public parks be used for sex? This is Buena Vista Park, 37 acres in the center of the city. Today, it's one of the pieces of territory claimed by the men of the gay community. For the average person, it may not be dangerous to go into this park, but when we came here with our camera crew, a group of gay men surrounded us and forced us to leave. A week later, we came back without our crew, but with a home movie camera. This is what we found. From sunup to sundown, men everywhere. Hundreds of them coming to this park each day for public sex.
We went up there and we saw a streaker, and another man which was with him said if we told anyone, he'd beat us up.
For the gay men of San Francisco, cruising in Buena Vista Park is done without shame. Their sexual encounters here are guided by a ritual that calls for anonymity. The men don't exchange names. They barely even talk as they follow each other into the bushes for sex.
We were trying to take a shortcut home, and I thought that maybe a path would bring me down the hill. And then we saw these men all doing strange stuff.
What do you mean, Laura?
Well, one didn't have his clothes on, and then all the rest were looking at him.
Greg and Laura live with their family in this house on the edge of the park.
we talked to a policeman before we moved in, and we asked them what it was like to be around here, and they said that there are homosexuals around, but I really didn't imagine that the homosexuals community would be having sex in the park.
Do you worry for your children?
Oh, I'm very worried for the children.
It's not one incident, it's the whole sequence of things that keep the kids out of the park, that affect the kids one way or another, and I don't really know what way. And I resent the fact that they're interfering with my rights. They have rights, but they don't have more rights than I do.
There was a park and recreation meeting because there's some funding that could be used to improve the park. And we went, and there were a few other neighbors who went to this meeting. And the rest of the people who were there were homosexuals who packed the meeting hall. They were not just from this area. They were from outside the area. And when there were suggestions by the architect to build a playground on one side of the park, the gays just booed them down.
How did you feel?
Oh, I was just very upset. I felt like we were being railroaded out and that this wasn't our area anymore. You know, we couldn't even stand up and make a comment about it because they feel so strongly that they should be able to have public sex.
If we could only make and observe this distinction between public and private.
Columnist Charles McCabe was one of the earliest advocates of gay civil rights. But after the City Hall riots, he wrote a series of critical articles that provoked a menacing response from the gay community.
It was difficult for you to agree to this interview.
Yes, that's a fact, as you know only too well.
And one of the factors was your own personal safety, wasn't it?
I hate to have to say it. Yes.
The threats against McCabe followed his appeal to the gays to respect traditional values. He was trying to warn them of a backlash if they didn't stop flaunting their sexuality.
You are the only person that I know of in this entire community that represents any of the established institutions, journalistic, political, business, the schools, who has spoken out publicly. Does that mean that no one else is concerned?
Oh, no. Everybody's concerned. I mean, unless I'm totally deaf, dumb, and blind. Everybody is concerned about the fact that the entire character of the city is being changed.
Then why don't you hear anyone talking out?
The numbers terrify them.
The numbers of
the
gays.
The numbers terrify them. That's what was doing.
They don't know what the gay community might
and they
do.
And they really don't know what they stand for, and they had a hideous example of what could happen in the City Hall riots.
There was one other person who spoke out and who came to regret it. Mayor Feinstein was also an early supporter of gay civil rights. Her principal rival, Quentin Kopp, was mistrusted by them. And so, it looked as if the gay vote was hers. But then, she gave an interview to the Ladies' Home Journal that changed everything. All she said was that gays should observe community standards. They shouldn't force their lifestyles on others. But this seemingly moderate criticism outraged the homosexual community. And suddenly, the gay vote Feinstein had counted on was turning against her.
She made a comment to the Ladies' Home Journal. You know it quite well. Did you all have something to do with encouraging her to take a different course?
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Answer it, Gary.
Well, I, for one, have talked to her specifically about those comments, and she wouldn't make them again. That's all I can say.
Jerry Berg and Burley Sutton are two of the gay leaders Dianne Feinstein turned to for help.
It boils down to a certain extent to mathematics. If you assume out of a city of 700,000 that there are 100,000 gay adults, that's roughly 15% of the voting population. No candidate for public office in his or her right mind is going to go out of his way to alienate 15% of the voting public. In fact, they will do just the opposite.
Could I have your attention, please? Could I have your attention for a minute? It's not that we think...
Law Wilson, the legal advisor to the chief of police, introducing his lover, Alan Johnson.
Law and I are celebrating our first anniversary. We met at the Advocate Experience a year ago, and we've just had a marvelous year. And we are very, very thrilled that Mayor Feinstein has joined us this evening.
to meet you. I'm Lauren McAllister.
And so, Dianne Feinstein began to court the gay vote.
Good to see you.
These were the people she needed to win over first. The establishment of the gay community.
So cool.
Men like Jim Hormel of the Hormel Ham family. He's director of the Advocate Experience.
Well, in essence,
a kind of est for gays.
Richard is obsessed with greed and power.
For these men, political power is only one of many goals. Bob Sass is chairman of the Human Rights Foundation. He's doing something that frightens many heterosexuals. He's working to introduce what the gays call a demystification program into the schools.
Its basic goal is exactly what it says. It's the demystification. It's the education of the general public. It's not an attempt to convert, but simply acquaint children of a formidable age that differences exist with respect to sexual orientation.
And will it present homosexuality as a alternative, normal lifestyle?
Yes.
Because that's
I consider it a normal lifestyle, certainly.
Whether it's normal or not, scenes like this remain difficult for the straight world to accept. For Dianne Feinstein, the problem was more complex. She had an election to win, and her homosexual friends were now telling her that mere acceptance of this lifestyle was not enough. She must become an advocate of their causes.
It was exciting for us when it came time to raise some substantial funds for the Human Rights Foundation. We invited a number of city officials, including the mayor. The price of the evening was $500.
What you're saying is that the mayor of San Francisco personally contributed $500 to the Human Rights Foundation, which is working to introduce the teaching of homosexuality into the schools.
That's one of our programs.
It's incredible, isn't it?
Well, it's satisfying to us because we feel so strongly about these programs that we love to have support from everywhere, and the mayor's office is most welcome.
You can't get more established than that, can you?
Well, we've been accused of being various.
CBS Reports will continue.
I'm looking for the newest thing in watches.
Have you seen the new Bulova's? They even have a watch now with a musical alarm. This is our Lady Bulova room, where thin is in. Elegant styling, gold.
How about diamonds?
You want quartz accuracy? Bulova is so accurate, it went to the moon.
Time ahead of its time. That's Bulova watch time.
For 30 years I've been a hairdresser in Hollywood, where hot lights cause dry hair. I never found anything better for dull, dry hair than Alberto VO5 conditioning hairdressing. We use a touch of VO5's concentrated formula before setting or combing to put hair in healthy-looking condition so it looks natural, easier to comb. VO5 could be just as fabulous for you. Give your dull, dry hair the star treatment with Alberto VO5 conditioning hairdressing.
Wrecked American aircraft in an Iranian desert. I'm Charles Kuralt. The rescue raid that failed is our cover story tomorrow on Sunday morning.
Bert Quint brings the story home. We call him the fireman because he's best when the heat is on.
Cronkite and Company, only on the CBS Evening News.
This is CBS.
Channel 2 weatherman Irv Jakovsky, Mr. G.
I think the first time I can remember falling in love with weather was the first time I can clearly recall a big snowstorm in this town.
I think it's important for a weatherman to really have a feel for the area that he's forecasting in. I've been with weather maps and working computers and teaching my kids for 13 years, and that's important in forecasting.
Mr. G, when you need to know about the weather, quick as you can say, newsbreaker.
He's there and on the air.
Model turned doctor on to life, Tuesday, 7:30.
Do you feel there'll be a gay mayor one day?
I don't feel certain about anything. There were a lot of gay people doing a lot of work in Germany before Hitler. And there was a huge movement, the German homosexual emancipation movement, and it was wiped out. You know, the odds, I think, are still against us, but I'm optimistic.
It was a very decadent society, if you remember it, the Berlin Cafe Society. Yeah. Isn't it a sign of decadence when you have so many gays emerging, breaking apart all of the values of a society.
I don't see that as a sign of decadence. Perhaps the values of society are decadent. Perhaps they need to be broken up.
Arts Ball. It's a tradition in San Francisco. A night when gay men dress up as women and anything else that suits their fancy. A night when men can compete in a beauty contest for the prettiest costume. It's an old institution in the gay community, but with a new wrinkle. This year, the Beaux-Arts Ball became a major stop on the campaign trail.
Hi, can I say hello here? I'm David Scott.
At first, no one took him seriously, but David Scott, the gay candidate, was about to become the most significant single factor in the campaign.
You're talking the next mayor of San Francisco.
Oh,
see, here's my picture. See? Isn't that cute? What district?
David, this is a real woman.
I could tell. I could tell,
nice,
and she's a beautiful woman.
It's nice that you're pitching a minority here tonight.
The gay community.
Yeah. The gay community of San Francisco.
Okay.
Tell me, why do you laugh when you think of the gay community of this city?
I didn't laugh.
Quentin Kopp, the candidate, thought to be the least supportive of gay causes. But even he was campaigning here.
Yeah, thanks for the check, too.
I've never seen a mayoral candidate walking the plank out there among the drag queens and being received in such
a... Oh, I don't think it's any different than being introduced at any other kind of a campaign function and being asked to come on to the platform and wave and say hello to people. It's all part of campaign.
Oh, how you doing, boy?
But in this city, an integral part of campaigning is trying to deal with the gay community.
An integral part of campaigning is campaigning among all segments of San Francisco, which is a very diverse city.
I would like to introduce to you, escorted by her boyfriend and lover, the mayor of our city, Dianne Feinstein.
They loved having her there, but Mayor Feinstein was still in political trouble with the gay community. And now, just 10 days before the election, she was here to win back the gay vote.
We are very proud of the many contributions that San Francisco's gay community has made to our city in the professions, in the arts, and in many different endeavors. Thank you very much. Thank you.
From her perspective, this appearance at the Drag Queen's Ball was a major gesture. She'd been lavish with her praise. She'd even embraced Michelle, the city's leading transvestite. What more can you want from a straight mayor than the kinds of things Dianne Feinstein was doing?
A lot more. Dianne Feinstein talks about setting standards. We're going to make it clear to her that we'll set our own standards. Thank you.
Hedonism for San Francisco.
I'm not saying what it's going to be. I'm saying that we'll decide for ourselves.
The problem is, the gay lifestyle was already creating a backlash in the city. Nowhere is this more apparent than Halloween night on Castro Street.
Just go right on by now.
It's a custom in this old family neighborhood to begin Halloween with a party for the children. The tradition remains. But since the gays took over here, they've introduced a new experience for the kiddies.
This way, Princess, the Lord will give you tickets.
believe that, Lord. Oh, my Lord, my mother.
You have two types of Halloween in San Francisco. You have it in the traditional nationwide sense, and then, of course, you have it in the gay areas of Halloween. And, of course, they present two different types of problems.
For Captain George Jeffries, Halloween has become a nightmare. Each year in this night, more and more young toughs have been coming into the gay areas to beat up homosexuals. The night of the City Hall riots, Jeffries' own men had burst into a bar on Castro Street, attacking gays with billy clubs. It had been called a police riot. But on this Halloween night, no matter what their feelings, Jeffries' men were supposed to protect the gays.
Just describe what you have in the way of manpower taking care of the Castro area tonight.
I have available sufficient reserves in the event that it gets out of control for whatever reason.
Attack freedom over one.
Cleve Jones and the other gay activists still saw the police as the enemy, and insisted that they alone provide security on Castro Street.
Let's all stick together.
But how to go about it? Halloween in San Francisco is a night of costumes, a night to mask one's identity. As he plunged deeper into the crowd, Jones didn't yet know that someone had just slashed his lover's face with a razor. What else might happen? How could he be sure who was straight and who was gay? Who was here simply to have fun? And who had come with violence in mind.
Your particular responsibility is what?
I am the bike commander. I have a group of 30 motorcycles going from the Castro area.
Millwald was part of the gay security force.
Checking, make sure that when people are leaving the area, they're not jumped by other groups waiting for them.
During the day, what's your ordinary work?
My ordinary work is a sadomasochist consultant, or best known as an S&M consultant.
Your specialty is sadomasochism.
Right.
That's your profession?
Yes. I do, part of my profession is I teach police departments, coroners, doctors.
Coroners?
Coroners about S&M, what is S&M, so that when they see a body with certain ties, certain implements around, how to distinguish whether it was a forcible, non-forcible, whether the bondage was something that they got into or didn't, whether it was willing or not.
You mean a lot of the S&M sex ends up in death?
Not necessarily. There are some. It does land up in either death or damage.
Yeah, but do you teach other people about S&M? Can I ask you? Oh, Lord, it's a very strange place.
As the night wore on, it looked as though there would be no major confrontation between straights and gays. But it had been an ordeal for Captain Jeffries' men. For hours now, they had stood by silently as the gays provocatively taunted them.
Can I get your reaction?
No.
Why? I mean, when you look out and see all of these people in different costumes, different sexes...
You'll have to make that judgment for yourself.
Your job is just to contain it.
We're going to do what our orders are as they come along and handle it.
Many, many times, you may not agree with the law, or you may agree with it, but you have to, you work for the community, you have to operate by their standards.
Isn't it difficult for some of your men that are family men? Maybe?
Well, certainly it is. It's like I said before. But a policeman, quite frankly, as a professional, isn't or shouldn't have personal prejudice. At least they shouldn't spill over into his job.
2 a.m., a small fight broke out, and the police used it as an excuse to move on to Castro Street.
I don't know what they're doing.
Jones and the monitors were desperately trying to keep the gays from fighting back. They didn't want to give the police another chance to attack.
Around the corner.
I called you on those walkie-talkies, and they said you didn't.
talk to me.
I never heard that. I never got that message. Please, long time, you're hurting my guest.
You're hurting me, Gary.
You're going to deal with me, brother.
I want to deal with you. I came here mellow.
Well, then get mellow, I guess.
Honey, please calm down. Please. I don't want you to get hurt.
Cleve, you're a friend of mine. You're a dear friend of mine. But politics is politics. I'll fight the bastard till I die.
But the night no longer belonged to the gays.
In the end, the police moved into your street, Castro, and took it.
Yeah. They just marched right in. They clubbed the monitors. They clubbed me.
If you'd turned it around and you'd urged people to confront the police,
that would have been a bloodbath.
Do you believe that? Do you think that the gays of this community would turn on the police if urged by their leaders?
They've done it before.
Halloween had been humiliating for the gays, but in just 4 days, they would reemerge with the one strength no one could take away from them, the power of their vote.
Hot. Hair that's shiny hot. That's the look you get with Alberto VO5 Hot Oil Treatment. Hair that's shimmering soft and sexy hot. Heat it up with VO5 Hot Oil Treatment. It professionally restores healthy texture and radiance to hair damaged by hot rollers, perms, even blow dryers. Just heat it up. Massage it in and shampoo. VO5 Hot Oil Treatment. You add the heat. We do the rest.
It's midnight, and you lost your traveler's checks.
My name's Keegan. Where's my money?
Because they're Citicorp traveler's checks, we can get you emergency funds through Western Union. 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Citicorp, America's leading banking institution worldwide.
Thanks.
Take advantage of our size.
Looks like rain.
Travel the world with us, Citicorp traveler's checks.
Okay, now think of that incredible moment, because you grow up in this country like most gays at a time when you were helpless and
felt weak. Very true.
So now you, David Scott, are sitting in your house waiting for the mayor of San Francisco to come talk to you, ask for your support.
That's right.
November 7th, the morning after the election, and Dianne Feinstein was in political trouble. The gay strategy had been to draw enough votes to David Scott to force a runoff. The strategy worked. And now Feinstein would have to face Quinton Kopp in a new election December 11th. The mayor had come here to Scott's house trying to win his endorsement and the gay votes that went with it. But she had counted on this being a private meeting, a chance to plead her case discreetly. And then Scott told her we were there.
Hi.
George Crile, I wonder if you could tell me, are you here just to clarify your position with the gay community, or are you ready to start bargaining?
No, I'm not here to bargain. I'm here to talk to David Scott.
We're just going to have a nice visit. We're old friends, and we knew each other from before. And
well, Mr. Scott said that you'd have to make certain concessions.
We're going to have a nice visit. We're going to have a nice visit at my home.
Mr. Scott hasn't said that to me, so we're just going to sit down and
we're
going to
have a nice visit together.
That's all. Okay.
We'll see you later.
It wasn't just Mayor Feinstein. Within 2 days, her rival, Quinton Kopp, would make this same pilgrimage to plead his case. It was now clear that the gays held the swing vote in the runoff election. Feinstein and Kopp were faced with a dilemma of how to win that vote.
Both would start making concessions, and both would have to reconsider past statements that seemed to be critical of the conduct of the gay community. The problem for straight politicians courting the gay vote is that some things about the homosexual community here are undeniably troubling, but politically dangerous to challenge.
There are things which divide the straight and gay communities. I suppose one of them are sexual mores.
Very definitely.
What kind of people will use this sort of thing? Is it the lunatic fringe of the gay community?
No, it's everybody. It's bankers, lawyers, doctors. We sell to all types of clientele.
There are a number of things that happen in the gay community which go from the leather bars to the glory holes and to the S&M parlors. Do you all support all those things, or do you draw a line on some of them and say we ought to clean it up?
I'm willing to take it. I support them. With the proviso that these are things that people are doing in private. That if you want to go to the glory holes or you want to go to an S&M bar, you go there knowing that's what it is. It's the choice of the individual to do what he or she wishes to do.
He is your slave. That is correct. He's my property. And do you accept that?
Yes.
Your worst fantasy has already been lived out by many of these people, and they're on to bigger and better things.
Dr. Stevens, you're the coroner of San Francisco, and recently you've been talking about a new kind of problem that you're facing. Could you tell us about it?
We've been seeing for a while now that about 10% of our homicides related to homosexual behavior. And this ranges from just general homosexual type behavior, an individual who goes to a bar, picks up another person of their own sex, through including sadomasochism with bondage and severe injury.
What are all these things, Mel?
They're different toys that are used in different manners through the different sessions.
We last met Mel Wald on Halloween. On this night, he took us to one of San Francisco's commercial establishments where you can rent a torture chamber. This one is publicly licensed, perfectly legal.
Board of Education. Very interesting. Has the holes, and when it's used, it can leave a lot of interesting marks. Regulation nightstick, wonderful to be used as a dildo.
We were told about an institution in this city where people are involved in S&M activities, mm-hmm. in which they're so dangerous that they have a gynecological table there with a doctor and nurse on hand to sew people up.
Yes, I've heard of these places. We see right now.
Well, why are they allowed to flourish?
Currently, there's no law against it.
And as you, as the coroner, when you go to the city's politicians or the police force and tell them that you're seeing something which is growing and may be very dangerous, what sort of response do you get?
From the police department, we get great response. Police department and my office work together closely. From the city, we get no response.
Burley, Jerry, Rusty.
What if Mayor Feinstein had gone through the campaign making the same kinds of comments she did for the Ladies' Home Journal and said there are too many sexual excesses and it's against the customs and traditions of this city? What would have happened to her in terms of the gay vote, Jerry?
She would not have had it.
Jerry can talk about the gay community and its standards, but the mayor has difficulty. If you're not a member of our minority, I think you're on really shaky footing by pointing to it in general terms and saying, clean up your act.
So I would like to introduce at this time the mayor of San Francisco, Dianne Feinstein.
From the standpoint of the gay community, Dianne Feinstein had to clean up her act. David Scott, the kingmaker in this runoff election, was now insisting that each of the candidates atone for past anti-gay statements. From the mayor, he wanted a public apology. And so, for Dianne Feinstein, still tainted by the Ladies' Home Journal comment, it was now or never.
I don't come to you as a perfect person that knows all of the answers and that doesn't make mistakes. But I do come to you as somebody who's got a heart and a concern and a very deep interest and desire to represent this community. And maybe at times I have been insensitive. It wasn't because of any calculated reason. If I'd said things that the community has found offensive or doesn't understand, I apologize for that.
Hello, Mayor Feinstein. What I want to know is, what changed your mind from June when you didn't think you needed us until 3 weeks before the election when you thought you needed us? Why did you change so drastically without any other reason than getting our vote?
Quite frankly, the tone of that meeting was such.
She didn't answer this question to anyone's satisfaction. but it didn't matter. Everyone here knew that the mayor had just apologized. And it wasn't just an apology. She'd offered them a gay police commissioner and political appointments in proportion to their numbers in the city. In short, she had given them all they had asked for. It was now time for David Scott to decide. Feinstein had offered everything. Cop, nothing but rhetoric. It was Christmas time, 3 days before the runoff election, and Dianne Feinstein had just received her gay present. David Scott had endorsed her. From that moment on, he seemed to never leave her side. She became the darling of the Castro. It had been a long time since she said she wouldn't pander for the gay vote. Already forgotten were her scoldings about community standards. The night before the election, Scott even had her go to the leather bars to take her campaign to the S&M community. The gay vote went overwhelmingly for Feinstein.
Quentin Kopp just conceded defeat. The mayor, who's been elected by all the people of San Francisco, our mayor, Dianne Feinstein. Your mayor.
I'd like particularly to thank everyone that's standing behind me, those members of the Board of Supervisors. I would also like very much to thank Mr. David Scott for his support, if I may.
The mayor had reason to thank Scott. It was his block of votes that gave her the victory.
She made promises that she did not want to make, that she had refused to make. We got it out of her, and we'll see now if she lives up to them.
What can you do to make her live up to the promises now?
Frighten her. I mean, she has to look at this. There is a new and turbulent community in this city that is strong and has increasingly clear demands upon the city in which we live.
And if it doesn't get its way?
We'll get our way through the ballot box.
And the street.
And the street.
This event took place 2 weeks before the election. It was the first anniversary of Harvey Milk's assassination, and the gays of San Francisco were demonstrating their newfound power. There had been growing concern here about the homosexual community. But until the election, the city's establishment hadn't taken this new political movement seriously, hadn't tried to challenge or control it. And now, the gays were warning the city that gay power had come of age, and that this was only the beginning.
How many of you have heard from behind, "Hey, faggot! Hey, dyke!" That is why we are here tonight. That is why we marched on Washington. That is why we will keep on marching. It will be a long struggle. And we will have leaders and slogans and martyrs aplenty. But let no one misunderstand. We are deadly serious. We are growing in power with every day that passes. And we will not be stopped.
Really, the most impressive thing was that I could lose weight without feeling hungry. Dexatrim helped me lose weight that I couldn't lose all by myself.
These people have written to us about the Dexatrim diet plan, the remarkable time-release way to lose weight. Just one Dexatrim capsule can help curb your appetite during meals and in between for up to 12 full hours.
Well, I've tried many diet plans, diet pills, but your product worked for me.
Proved effective in 7 years of clinical testing. Try Dexatrim, the time-release way to lose weight.
That's Coach Johnson. He's from the college. Looks like he's worried about his problem dandruff. I wish he'd ask me.
Mr. Owens, I need a shampoo.
Ever tried Tegrin?
Can it really work on my itching and flaking?
Well, in a national survey, 3 out of 4 dermatologists judge Tegrin's medication effective in fighting even problem dandruff.
Mm-hmm. I give it a tryout.
Hey, how's that dandruff problem?
Tegrin's a winner, Mr. Owens.
Prove it to yourself. Tegrin works.
We looked at Celica, Accord, and Scirocco. But when we looked at this new Mazda 626, that's all it took.
Just one look. That's all it took. Yeah, just one look. That's all it took.
We really like the way this Mazda 626 performs, not to mention its great mileage, all at a price that makes it really worth looking at.
Yeah, the more you look, the more you like.
You'll learn the meaning of easy cleaning with the only foam that's Lysol. When you foam the tub, you don't have to scrub with the only foam that's Lysol.
When I clean the bathroom, I want to know I'm killing germs, so I use Lysol Basin Tub and Towel Cleaner. Its foaming action kills household germs, shines without scratching, stops mold and mildew. Lysol Basin Tub and Towel Cleaner, the only foam that's Lysol.
It may be that San Francisco is unique, and it couldn't happen anywhere else. But if Kinsey is right, upwards of 20 million Americans are homosexual. And as we saw at that march in Washington last October, gay political organizations are active all across the country. The right of homosexuals to organize, like any other minority seeking to further its own interests, is no longer in question. The question is, what will those interests be? Will they include a demand for absolute sexual freedom, as they did in San Francisco? And if so, will this challenge to traditional values provoke far more hostility and controversy when it is put to the test elsewhere? It is no longer a matter of whether homosexuals will achieve political power, but what will they attempt to do with it? I'm Harry Reasoner. Good night.
Secretary of Defense Harold Brown will be the guest on Face the Nation tomorrow. And Sunday evening, catch 60 Minutes. Then at Archie Bunker's place, Archie wants Murray out, the State Tax Department wants Archie in. And on a special showing of the all-new Stockard Channing Show, Susan hits 30 with a party that's a riot on wheels. On CBS tomorrow night.
Monday on Lou Grant, William Shallard guest stars as the alcoholic husband.